96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Networks.
Good afternoon, Baha. Welcome to the Hit Back. I'm your host, Nahaja Black. Was having some technical issues on my side today. I hope that everyone is doing well, that you are taking care of yourself, that we are indeed living our best life, right? So that's the big deal. Want to welcome everyone to the show. Happy that you are alive and well, that you're listening, tuning in. Again, you could be listening to anyone at any time, but you choose to join us here on the show, The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. So thank you again for being such great, supporters of the show. All right, so we got news to update you on, and I'm excited for the show that we're going to have. At the top of the show, we were supposed to have guests there, and I think I see him now. If you haven't heard, there are some missing pilots, missing persons, in a small aircraft in some of our waters, and we are, you know, folks are genuinely seeking and searching for them. And I have joining me now, because we have a lot to discuss, so I have joining me to the top of the show, because this is so important, of Mr. Charles Sawyer. Mr. Sawyer, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you, Nahaja. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. I wish we were meeting under better circumstances. But it's always good to connect, and there's no better time like the present. So tell us a bit about what, this rescue mission that we are trying to accomplish here, Mr. Sawyer.
Okay, where we're at is, the Defense Force has been down there. We have a couple of people from down at Auckland and Crooked Island. The U.S. Coast Guard had joined in. My kudos to them. Thanks to them. Also to Head Nose, who lined up everything. We are now in the process of putting some people on the ground in Auckland. We have a couple of us going down tomorrow on Hamasail to make sure that we establish the connection and everything. We're now, well, presently, I'm at the Defense Force Base. We're doing a briefing with them right now. So we're doing quite a bit, because the point is, two lives are very important. So the point is to get these lives, no matter what the deal is, pull out all the stuff and just get down.
Yeah.
Okay. I feel very strongly that my brother is still out there. I know he's a survivor. And so that is why I give up not on finding him. Right? Mm-hmm. He's a survivor. He got some MacGyver mood. So I trust, and God is always able.
We've had in recent history, quite a bit of stories of persons who were, found out to sea alive and well. And one of the things that I believe, Mr. Sawyer, is that your brother, and I think his name is Stephen Sawyer. And then we also have the pilot who's also missing as well, that we have to pull out all of the stops and search relentlessly. I mean, there have been searches that have been over a year. so searching relentlessly, but in particular in this timeline, what information can you share with us about when your brother and the pilot were last spoken to, last heard from? What information you can share, and how can we as citizenry, maybe some fishermen are listening. I know that you have a lot of help out there, but how best can we help in any way? So firstly, any information that you can tell us about the last time there was a correspondence. Can you hear me, Charles?
Okay, now on Friday morning, they left around seven to go down to DR. Yes, they left after seven on Friday. The last telephone communication was about 9:11 a.m. We were able to check the black box, and that coincided around the same time that they lost communication as well. So we figured that's about the time when the plane went down, and it was right around the area of Salina Point, Auckland. So that is what we were working with. We have now established a Facebook page as well as a GoFundMe page. Like I said, we put out all the stuff to try and find these two lives. So it's oh God, it just blew fuse.
Yeah, that's okay.
The Facebook page and the GoFundMe page is mm-hmm. including the two of them, because you know even though that's my brother, he was not the only one. So we're looking at the both persons to get the two of them alive and well.
And the pilot's name is.
I feel that they are still out there.
Yeah.
Say it again.
And the pilot's Mr. Clifford.
Because they, you know, my brother's a survivor. Mm-hmm. Clifford Dean, correct. So you know, I feel that they're still alive. They're out there. They need help, because after 4 days, you know, the weather was not so good, but you know, then you get they can be dehydrated. So you need to find them as quickly as we can. This is why we're putting out all the stops to try and get down there. Like I said, we got three people going down tomorrow on Bahamas Air to make sure that we get some people on the ground to make some things happen. Bajra, Defense Force, Coast Guard, all of them are involved. But we feel like it's only fair and it's only right that we get in there and, you know, put us, so to speak.
Yeah. Yeah, right. And
so it's all out. Mm-hmm. We're doing everything that we can to find these two.
Yeah, no, and it's you know, like I said, we've heard of some great you know, testimonies and stories of persons. I remember the young Sammy was on my show after weeks of being missing, or you know, at least I think it was about 10 days or so missing out to sea. And so there are wonderful stories of people being found. And so that's why we persist in seeking and searching. The GoFundMe page, and I know this is expensive. Search and rescue is not a cheap endeavor, especially for, you know, civilians, as you continue to try and, you know, find your brother and find the pilot. The GoFundMe information, I just got it, and I want to share it. And I see if I can copy the link and share it on the page here. But for those who want to, do you have, by any chance, any way that you're telling them search Stephen Sawyer? How would you have them find this GoFundMe page, the best way you can figure out? Okay, we lost. Unfortunately, we lost Mr. Sawyer, brother of Stephen Sawyer. Let's see if we can get Charles back. But the long and short of it is, that there are some challenges, but we want to keep our prayers going for this family, for both families, the pilot and Mr. Sawyer. And I see we have Charles back. Charles, really quickly, how can people support the fund to help find your brother and the pilot?
Okay, the Facebook page and the GoFundMe page, Rescue Stephen Sawyer and Cliff,
Clifford Dean.
Cliff Dean, Bahamas. Right. Rescue Stephen Sawyer and Cliff Dean, Bahamas. So that is the way it is set up. And so whatever they can do, we're pleading with people to, you know, we got boats, people need to go out. We've been able to set up a credit account with the gas station in Salina Point that people can get gassed up to get out on the sea to make searches. So we've got a couple of things done. We got a couple people who sat up on the ground. So a couple of divers and those coming in to just make it a full-fledged thing. And I my appreciation to all those folks from Auckland who decided to help us out. I can't say thank you enough and show my gratitude towards all those who are putting their hands in to help us out. Because, mm-hmm. like I say, we're Bahamians. We're pulled together in crisis. So this is one of those times when we are pulled together.
Yeah, and you know what? We are praying for you, praying for your family, praying for Mr. Dean's family, that this is a positive outcome. We are believing. And like you said, your brother is a survivor. He has some MacGyver moves. And we know our Bahamian men, we are, you know, they're very resilient, very strong. And so we'll be fine. And, you know, they'll come home safely. So we're praying for you, Mr. Sawyer. And we will be keeping staying connected to the story in any way that you need our help here at the Hit Back at Guardian. Please don't be shy. Let us know. All right. Thank you so much. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. That was Mr. Charles Sawyer really trying to get the word out. And it's very recently, it seems like we've had a lot of these incidences. We know that with the loss of young Mr. Ferguson and his flight, that there were some things that were supposedly changed with the way that we do rescues and the way that we handle this recovery of the rescue procedure. So I am prayerful and hopeful that we will get this done and that we will have Stephen and Clifford home at last. So we also have joining us on the show, and I see my guest waiting in the waiting room, and his camera is extremely foggy and needs to be cleaned up a bit. So I just need him to really quickly deal with that before we started. But if you have been following the show, yesterday on the Hit Back, I opened up with a soliloquy, a little long diatribe on a voice note that I heard. This voice note that I heard, and Craig, that was no better. I don't know what's going on there. This voice note that I heard was very concerning. It was very concerning because we had what seemed to be, and I still am unable, honestly, I'm unable to play it because of the profanity in it. And because I'm struggling with the cold and you can hear it in my voice, the challenge that I had was staying awake enough to focus on getting it done in terms of bleeping out the cuss words. But then, you know, if anything, I should, go to the police force and tell them that they were, you know, swearing and maybe they should charge themselves with profanity. But nonetheless, I think it's only a crime if you cuss them. It doesn't matter if they cuss you, but I digress. Terrible rule in the book. So whilst having that conversation or that monologue about this voice note of a young man being brutalized, this is what the voice note, brutalized by a assistant superintendent, Derek Ferguson. How do I know that name? Because Mr. Ferguson wanted, ASP Ferguson wanted whomever he was brutalizing to know or to recognize that this was he. I know that he, you know, and he said, do you know who I am? And unfortunately for him, I think he didn't wish that everyone knew who he was because of this viral voice note. Now, we all know who he is, and I gather he would wish that that was not the case. Nonetheless, we ended up having that discussion, and wonderfully, wonderfully so. The young man, his mother heard that entry. And yesterday we had an exclusive on the Hit Back where the young man, Mr. Charles Butler, shared his story on the air, shared how the context of it, that he had used one of his smart devices to record once he was uncuffed. And this is what he's alleging, that once he was uncuffed, he used a smart device to record. He was sitting he's watching the other officer who is sitting next to in front of where he says, you know, you're just going to copy and paste from one and place it on his. This is what he's alleging. And you can hear it in the voice note, that exchange. but then in the background, you hear ASP Ferguson sounding as if he's violently smacking, slapping. And I thought what I heard was kicks. And the young Mr. Butler said that his friend was also body slammed. That was the words he used yesterday on the show. So this is what was said yesterday on the show. And as promised, I said today that I would continue with this story just because we need to see where it goes. What has to happen is a process of accountability. Somewhere midday, it was confirmed. I spoke with Superintendent Fulford today. Superintendent Fulford is the one who deals with these sort of integrity issues within the police force. And he gave me a response early in the day that was not as strong as the one that ended up this morning, ended up being as strong as Commissioner Paul Roll, whom I reached out to as well. So in the morning, it was, we heard this voice note. We are investigating it. Right now, these gentlemen are before the courts on various charges. So kind of not really wanting to discuss the voice note, saying, acknowledging that it existed. But these gentlemen are, in essence, kind of creating an idea that these gentlemen are before the court. So they must have committed some sort of crime, but that it is an investigation and they cannot speak on it. So that was earlier. And then as the day progressed, you saw The Guardian put up a story where Minister Dames of National Security stated that an voice note is happening. And then somewhere between 1-2 o'clock, you get a note that is that the Commissioner of Police has said that ASP Derek Ferguson, the gentleman whose voice was heard, name, he called himself out, that he has been suspended pending the outcome of this internal investigation. So that is the update. Now we welcome on the show Mr. Craig Butler, who has this 1999 camera that sees 16 doubles. Craig, welcome to the Hit Back, my friend.
I'm sorry for laughing. Good afternoon. And I'm so happy that you had me. Listen, let me apologize to you and everybody. This is an iPhone 11, but it fell. And I rolled on it with my wheelchair and I put a crack in it. So now it's got all these funny things and I got to get fixed.
It's a prism. It's like a prism of your face. It's fabulous. I mean, what can you say?
So listen, all right. You're seeing multiple shots of me. So that's good.
That's what it is. You got angles. Okay, Craig. This is your client. This young Mr. Butler is your client. I wanted to ask the first thing, Butler and Butler, any family to you?
That's my nephew. That's my brother's son. Absolutely.
Oh, wow. Wow. Okay. So then, of course, with that being said, when did you get the call that your services were needed from your brother?
My brother called me on Monday, which would have been March 1st. His son would have been taken into custody by the police down in the Awak Key area, somewhere around that Bank of the Bahamas, Keesok, and everything that was there. As you said, the voice note itself has a lot of profanity in it, so it's probably not fit for playing on the radio. Every other word is a profane word emanating from probably or possibly Ferguson and others, as we heard. I got the call on Monday. He was released from police custody on Monday at about 1 or 2 in the afternoon. He was arrested along with two of his friends who live in the same general vicinity, their brothers. And the first thing I did was to advise him to go immediately to a private clinic. I'm sorry, police give you this form. It's called Bahamas Police Form 70, BP-70. And it is something that is normally filled in at the Princess Margaret Hospital. Those people are overworked, overrun, understaffed. Do you think that they have time to properly fill out one of these forms? Mm. No, don't. And it has been my experience in the past that the police do this because they know they're going to get some in a minute, something very probably...
Okay. What's the purpose of the form? Sorry, just so that I understand the form.
The form is what the police send you to the hospital to say that you have been injured. And so they need that to go to the hospital with, but they want you to go to the hospital. Most people don't know that you can go to a private doctor. And I would always advise people to go to the private doctor because you're paying for the services. You will get seen. They will take all the pictures and they will give you a much more detailed report than somebody who's working on the staff at the Princess Margaret Hospital. Those people are highly overworked, underpaid, and, you know, stressed. So it's not that they are intentionally not doing a good job. It's just that they don't necessarily have the time to devote to it. So that would have been Monday, March 1st at about 2 o'clock. My brother called me. I would have met with them the following morning. I met with them that afternoon and then the following morning, and we went straight to the complaints unit.
So when you saw him, Craig, when you saw him, and if you're just tuning in, you're listening.
I saw him Monday. I saw him Monday afternoon before he went to the private doctor. I observed the injuries for myself.
And you saw them? You saw them?
Yes, I saw them. I saw them. The footprint was still on my nephew's shirt. You can see the big footprint he had on. You can see the footprint is there. The next thing I advised my clients to do, we took all of the clothes. The same clothes are not being washed. They've been put in bags, and we sealed it like it was evidence. I'm not fooling around with the police here. We saw that during the pandemic, we saw the Black Lives Movement. We saw the corruption in police forces, not only in the United States and Europe, but we also see some of it here. We have known of previous instances here of sweeping things under the carpet. We have a way of trying to get things just to go away. And I was not about to allow that to happen. And these are the steps that anybody who wants to have a successful complaint against the police need to take. I am pleased to see that the police have acted quickly in suspending or putting on administrative leave, were the words that they actually use, ASP Derek Ferguson. I am not here to cast aspersions upon anybody. I am here just to report the facts, and what took place to my nephew and those other two boys was despicable. This is 2021. This is March 9th. That sort of behavior should not be happening. These are three young men, 26, 23, and 19, who were leaving the Arawak Key area. They were minding their own business. And one of the other men was attacked by two young men out of a car. So in trying to get away from that fracas, this is when the police emerged. They came in not fully understanding what was going on, interjected themselves. And in that way, the other two boys, the Cartwright brothers and my nephew, were arrested, taken in the police station, and brutalized.
So I'm showing, for those who are in your car and you're unable to see this at the moment, I've been showing some of the images. And these were not, they're not, that's only three. There's a lot more. But for the sake of Mr. Butler, he doesn't wish for his face to be seen all over the place. There are videos that show even more extensive damage to his neck, his face. And we do know that based on his on what he's alleged and hearing from him yesterday on the show, that he has some, injuries to his chest, right? And so that's where the pain resides. Here it is, Attorney Craig Butler, and also your uncle to Mr. Butler. And there are two other persons, his friends, who are also a part of this civil or this complaint. And I don't know if it's been a civil case yet. Is it a civil case already?
Well, it's not a civil case already. The first thing that you have to do is go to the Complaints and Corruptions Unit that's up at the police headquarters on East Street. And once you go there, you make your complaint. They then give you the form to go to the hospital. Quite frankly, we went in there, all three of them made the complaints. I made sure that we sent the information back. Let me state this categorically. I had the audio, but I did not release the audio to the public. The audio was sent in. They have a email address, complaints@rbpf.org. And I sent it in along with the pictures and everything. And I outlined the complaint when I sent it in. So I'm only assuming that as it was a general mailbox, somebody could have picked it up. But categorically, I told my nephew and I told the other two young men who were involved not to send out the voice note, that it was under police investigation, and we did not want to do anything to harm that police investigation. So it did not emanate from us. But after it came out and after the other stuff came out, because some of the pictures even came out.
Oh. Craig, we lost you. Okay, so we have, there you are. You're back.
Okay. And told them not to do that.
Okay, so we're having some technical issues. Hold your thought there, Craig. You're muted. So we'll unmute you. Let's see if we can get some of this technical. Finish that thought because we'll go to a commercial break.
I don't know how the information has been disseminated to the public. But now that it's out in the public, I will more freely talk about it, although I am constrained as it is a matter under police investigation that you're not supposed to talk about it. But we can see already with Marvin Daines chiming in, with the commissioner chiming in, that this is something that they are going to take seriously. I will now approach Commissioner Paul Roll, see if I can generate a meeting with him and my clients. I do not believe that the charges are founded. I believe, quite honestly, and this is my belief, okay, I will fight for this in court. I believe that the assaulting the police officer charge was only put in there because they beat my client and the other two boys. As far as the obscene language, that's an oxymoron if I ever heard one, based on the amount of swearing that was emanating from the police themselves. In terms of disorderly conduct, in terms of resisting arrest, they never had a chance to do any of that. Tried charges. And I will not rest until all the charges have been dismissed, as well as we get a financial settlement for the abuse that the boys received at the hands of the police. This will not be tolerated in 2021 anymore. And this will not be tolerated in the Bahamas.
You're going to take a quick break. When we come back, more with the attorney of the three young men, not just Mr. Charles Butler, but the three young men who were allegedly assaulted at the police station. This is February 28th. This is weekend before last, eh?
Yes.
February 28th. And we'll dive into it because I have a question for you in terms of if you guys hadn't leaked the audio, do you believe that what has happened today, do you believe that there would have been any movement forward as strong as it is if this audio hadn't been leaked? I want to ask you that question right after this. All right, hold that thought. I see you're ready to answer that, but hold your thought. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. When we come back, more with this discussion with Mr. Craig Butler, the attorney for Mr. Charles Butler, and the two other young men who are alleging that they were abused by the police. We'll be back right after this. It continues to be a developing story. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM.
There's a thing you got to see. Hell! Never do anything to me.
This traffic report brought to you by Shield Insurance.
For my first look at traffic now, we've got several familiar areas out there that have congestions that are happening this early in the afternoon. It's a slow ride along West Bay Street already. Got a traffic line that's building over there. Isn't built up as yet, mind you, along East Bay Street. However, the inner city areas like Wolf Road, it's busy. Traffic is quite active back and forth. Key Street, Mackey Street, Robinson Road, and even Soldier Road. They've all got a level of busy traffic back and forth going on, but no concern as yet about delays and congestion. It's just busy. It's a bit slower around the Carmichael Road and Blue Hood Road traffic light area, while the ride up and down Carmichael Road itself is still an easy ride. The roundabout at Tony's Million Darling Highway and Samila Butler is busy on all sides, and traffic coming in from JFK, that's just building up right now. Even this early in the afternoon, the six-leg roundabout is busy on all sides, and the University Drive West lane into that roundabout is already the lengthiest line over there. Elsewhere, it's all still a reasonable ride. We've got some hitting the brakes, but not enough going on to constitute traffic jams or congestions as yet. This National Traffic Report is a service of Dr. Danny Johnson Associates at Foot and Ankle International. They offer the simplest and safest treatment for painful flat feet, bunions, hammer toes, sports medicine, and more. Visit Foot and Ankle International for relief. They're located Deansland atop the hill at Fort Charlotte. Call them at 322-5402. That's 322-5402. With your Ryan Scale, look at traffic in real time. I'm VA Double Ad. Back in an hour with another update.
Girl, Junior just showed me Bella Boy in his phone.
What you mean? He take picture of that good for nothing boy?
She don't want Bella hair. You say that? You know she always say that's my good child.
So what he doing in Junior's phone?
Oh, he there because the police looking for him. He on that wanted list.
Wanted since in your phone now?
Yes. shot. And when police won't find anybody quick, after something happened, they can send picture direct to your phone. Go to Google Play or App Store and search for Crack Crime Bahamas, then pick install and it will go straight to your phone.
There is also a section on missing persons.
Yes, girl. Everybody needs to get this app so police can tell us right away when these people go missing. Just like an alert system.
Yes, it has numbers for Crime Stoppers Bahamas so you can call and nobody knows you. Call directly to Miami and give the information without giving your name or anything about you. I tried the other day and when I hear Junior and his boys talking about where they hide those guns, I walk quick around the corner.
477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
Don't let your children get left behind. Get them immunized. They need immunizations to protect them from some diseases, to get into school, and to apply for some jobs. Contact your nearest clinic or healthcare provider to make an immunization appointment today. Protect their health and their future. Remember, immunizations are free at all government healthcare facilities. Prevent disease. Immunize, please.
This message has been brought to you by the Ministry of Health.
And we're back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Joining us now is Craig Butler, the attorney for Mr. Charles Butler, young Mr. Charles Butler. And are you allowed to mention the two names of the others, the other young men?
Mr. Joshua Cartwright and Mr. Stephon Cartwright.
And what are the ages of these young men?
19 and 23.
19 and 23. And Mr. Butler is
26.
Yeah. You know, there are so many questions with regard to the story, but I won't ask all of them. Here's the question that I wanted to ask you at the end of that segment. If this information wasn't leaked, if this audio wasn't leaked, how confident were you that there would have been any sort of punitive or even display of remorse, of contrition, of shock, of anything that you've seen so far because of this viral voice note?
Nothing was going to happen. Past experience tells me that I would have been stuck with going down that civil trial route, trying to prove it, having to prove on the preponderance of the evidence that these injuries only took place whilst they were inside the police station. But what it was going to come down to was their word, he said, he said. Okay, the three of them alleging one thing against the police. And without any more, it probably was going to be a stalemate and not go anywhere. We would have tried and it would have continued for a long time. The voice note being leaked, and you did say again before we went that, and I want to repeat, I did not and neither did my clients leak that came from themselves. However it was leaked, I am grateful in the end analysis that it was leaked because it now has traction. And because it has traction, people know about it. People want to see the type of behavior displayed by police to be eradicated from the police force. Most of the people on the police force, men and women, are decent men and women. And they work to protect the citizenry. But like in any organization, you would have one or two bad apples. Now, I do not know the story of ASP. I've only heard certain things, which I will not go into. But I think it was a good sign for the immediacy that this man has been placed on administrative leave. That in and of itself ought to indicate that there is more to this than meets the eye. That should be the measuring stick by which we go by. This is the fastest I've ever seen the police. Okay?
Yeah. And I'm with you on that. Go ahead.
I'm pleased by that. And I'm hopeful that between the Minister of National Security, Marvin Dames, and Commissioner Paul Rohl, that they would see fit to have a meeting with me, either of them. Let's try to cure this problem sooner rather than later. Our adjourn date is June 14th. These charges are unwarranted against these young men. I want the charges thrown out, and I want a settlement for them for the abuse that they received at the hands of the police. And whatever that means in terms of the police interdisciplinary force, what they have to do with their own procedures, that's on them. I just want the charges against my clients released, and I want them to get a financial settlement. Once we get that, we will then have, as Bahamians, have to ensure that our police force is acting up to its charter and is acting in a manner befitting the decent people of the Bahamas.
You know, it's so interesting. There's a question and multiple questions and comments regarding the new cameras. Right. So we are now our police officers, not all of them are supposed to be fitted with now the police cams, the body cams. Right. Curious, will you be seeking at the time of apprehension when this purported assault happened and these things were alleged to have happened that led to their detainment? Right. Are you seeking to get the body camera footage at this point, or has that been a thought?
Well, it's not clear that all of the police are fitted with body cams. And, you know, we don't know what type of body cams they have. There are various types of body cams. They have those ones now in police can't turn off. The minute mm-hmm. you put it on yourself, it automatically records. Then you have to go back and you download it, and all of the action goes in. There are some body cams that the police have the ability to turn on and off. I do not know what we have here in the Bahamas, so I can't say that right now. But if there is footage that is available, of course we would be seeking to get that footage. But, you know, this equipment may be along the lines of the $17 million we spent on drones and stuff, and we can't see anything about them either, can we?
Better throw that in there, Craig.
Yeah.
So now that we're, okay, with that said, we're moving now. This is a quick movement. I must say I'm astounded by it. And you brought up an interesting point that perhaps there must be more to it that we aren't aware of. Because this is the quickest. And I mean, the surprise to me was a suspension. Mind you, even though the perceived evidence was damning, I have to ask you on the movement of the, or on the position of the actual audio being leaked, do you believe that it was actually someone within the police force or in the complaints department, someone who heard this audio and was moved, compelled to say, you know what, ain't nothing gonna change, we need to release this, because listen, You hear Fergus in the back there. You're always doing this mess. That was my extra dialogue in there. Well, but your thoughts?
I concur with you 110%. I fully believe, and in my soul, I do not have any evidence of this. I am only assuming that it came from the police force. Okay, and that in and of itself raises many questions. We know about the blue line, or in the Bahamas, the black and white line.
Or the khaki line.
Khaki line. They normally protect themselves. And the fact that you feed one of your own to the public when a feeding frenzy is going on, you're either creating a sacrificial lamb or you have a bad apple. It could be anyone. We do not know what it is, but clearly, you know, fish is being thrown in the water, or blood's being thrown in the water for us to catch fish.
There's a chum activity going on for sure. But apart from ASP Ferguson, who announces himself, there is also the voice of an officer who is encouraging that sort of behavior. Are you aware of the name of that officer, the rank of that officer, and is he also a part of your complaint?
Well, the complaint listed ASP Derek Ferguson and others, because if you listen carefully, this was the person who, in my estimation, was clearly in charge and control. It's almost like the military type thing. So you follow your line.
The ranking order.
And so they would have fed off of him. You could hear their emotions feeding off of him. You can hear in some of the comments when you blight out all of the profanity, you can hear like they were encouraged and they were being egged on, and one or two of them were egging on the others. So we're seeking all of them. But at the end of the day, as Harry Truman said, the buck stops here. And it's my contention that the buck stops at ASP Derek Ferguson. What was quite interesting was on the charge sheet, ASP Derek Ferguson name does not appear.
I agree. I saw that as well, which was very surprising.
They tried to shield him. That, again, is another pointer and another indicator. They have a reserve superintendent there when clearly the active ASP had taken the lead. And this is the type of foolishness that happens. Mm-hmm. And this is the type of corruption, Ms. Black, that we have up and down. And this is what we have to stamp out. We cannot sit idly by and allow this to happen, because I got a big mouth and I could do things and I could get out there in the public. But what about all of those people who don't have a big mouth? What about all of those people who don't have anybody to stand up and talk for them? Mm. How many are being swept underneath the carpet without us knowing?
Oh, and it's a lot. It's a lot. It's quite a bit. Just yesterday, a mother called and spoke about her daughter who was gone away, came home with a degree and was allegedly assaulted by a police officer. So that's, trust me, the stories are endless. And my family as well, we can tell our own story. That's why for me, this is a big deal as well, that there must be checks and balances. And this should not be going on in a civilized society if we truly believe that we're special, or otherwise we're just, you know, I've said it many times, niggers on horse, enslaved and trying to, you know, enslave the rest of us. But I digress on that point. Let me get off my soapbox. Here it is now, Mr. Butler. And again, for those just tuning in, we are chatting with the attorney for young Mr. Charles Butler and the two other complainants, the young men who were a part of that incident. To help to paint the picture, if you haven't heard the voice note, you can feel free to go on to my page where I have uploaded it as a video format, so that you can listen, share it, because we need this thing to be exposed. We need more exposure, because what is done in the dark, it must be lit up, right? So part of that, what was interesting in the video there, or in the audio, was that your nephew was recording, and it was his friend that we're hearing in the background, right? It's his friend that we're hearing in the background that is being told if, you know, where the ASP is announcing who he is. As attorneys, I have many friends who are defense attorneys, and they all have the same cry of alleged police abuse, physical abuse in the court. As attorneys, why don't you guys come together and do something? Is there not something that you can do as members of the law fraternity, legal fraternity?
Well, put it this way. You heard them saying, take pictures of the young man near the beginning of the clip, right?
Mm-hmm.
My clients asked for medical assistance. Let me tell you what the police, in all of their infinite wisdom, did. They called the ambulance from the Princess Margaret Hospital that has probably one trained EMS person and then normally an untrained person to come down to the station. It's not medical personnel. The EMS and the porters are there to transport the sick people, probably put in oxygen lines, put mm-hmm. in a little drip or something like that, but get you to the hospital where you can be evaluated by the trained medical professionals. And so the police, in their infinite wisdom, only called the ambulance to see my nephew and the other two men. That is the level on which they treat people, okay? Mm-hmm. Thereby, you can draw many conclusions from this, Ms. Black, and I don't want to go into everything, but I mean, I think it's clear. They were looking, in my estimation, to downplay this. They were hoping that these were people who didn't know anybody, who were going to have no recourse, and this time they met the wrong person.
They met the wrong one. But do you think, where is the legal fraternity? How can you guys, is it possible for all of you defense attorneys? I've heard horror stories of defense attorneys showing up to their client who has a right to an attorney, the right to remain silent, all of these things. Well, I think that that's our right, right? Yeah. You never know nowadays, because apparently you don't have the right to even write your own statement, because somebody can actually put two people in the same room, can conjure up a statement and still get promoted. But we digress. So, boy, this place is something else. So we have that. They are, I've heard many cries. The one defense attorney said they were standing there outside. Their client, the client's girlfriend called, said, listen, you need to go. They took blah, blah, blah. And they get to the police station. The police says, nope, they're not there. They are spending hours trying to find their client, and the client was right where they said they would be. But when they finally do meet the client is a total mess, allegedly. Right?
Listen, I have to concur. Criminal practice and defense attorneys can tell you. We used to call it drive around. The police like to do drive around. They take a suspect, they put them in the car, and they have us as defense attorneys driving around like we're stupid. Oh, they're at East Street South. So you go to East Street South. No, they're at Carmichael Road. So you go to Carmichael Road. No, they this way. And they do that drive around, and they have the suspects in the car with them. And normally they got two police sitting on either side in the back, and only the good Lord know what's going on in the back of that car. I have heard the horror stories. I have had clients with the horror stories, and we have not been able to do anything about it because there's not the supporting evidence, because we tend to treat our authority figures in this country with reverence, and we do that with the police as well. We will tend to believe the police, and we know that we do have a certain bad criminal element in this country. And it certainly doesn't help when on that bad criminal element, you know, you a parent, and you'll always be a parent first. And we hear the mothers out there, oh, my good son.
Oh, well, my good son.
And done kill a couple of people. Or your good son. Well, so everybody don't necessarily have a good son. Right? Mm-hmm. So some people got bad sons and some people got bad daughters. That's just what it is, right? But every mother and every father feeling that love for their children, I know you know exactly what I'm talking about. Your children will always be, that's my good child. Mm-hmm. Okay? Okay?
And you ain't on my mommy, because once that boy went off, she's like, get him out of my house. Tell him don't call me. I don't care wherever he is. We just have him here alive today. The brother in his 50s. Look at God. Won't he do it? But we digress.
But how many people still like your mother, Miss Black? How many people were strong like that? We lost a lot of that now because we have parents when their children were the antagonist. Mm-hmm. We have parents who to beat up the other kids when their children were the ones who caused the problems. And you know, I'm not here to speak about family situations, but we have to start looking at the environment. Some of this and the education level, all of this has a direct effect on criminality in the country. Mm-hmm. And, you know, every year when we're putting out students with almost 60% leaving with a certificate of attendance, what do you think we're doing, Miss Black? We're creating a criminal army for people to take advantage of these young men and young women because they're unemployable, many of them. And so the criminal element comes, picks them up, and uses them. Now, I've digressed there, but if that's taking place on the one hand, we got some of them who ended up in the police force. We've got some pure, hardened criminals in the police force.
That's deep.
Yeah, we do. We have to weed them out. Okay? We have to weed them out.
After
21 years of practice, I can say unequivocally, we got criminals on the police force.
Unequivocally. You're saying that this is, and I'm with you on that. I think we don't even do mental health checks. We got a lot of people who
it's the same police commissioner. And I was really perturbed, you know, because I'm a person, I suffer from depression. And it's the same police commissioner who came out a couple of weeks ago and talked about young men being weak and everything. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is the type of mentality that we have on our police force. And if it's coming from the top down like that, what do you expect the rank and file to do? We mm-hmm. must be respectful of mental health. And, you know, as Black people in the Bahamas, and especially a man, we didn't think it too much to go and try to get professional help or anything like that. We don't want that. We want to. But I'm sorry, if you need the help, you go and get it. And we don't demean people because they're seeking help and assistance. The police are supposed to be there to help. This gentleman clearly exceeded all of the powers under the Police Act and, I'm sorry, exceeded all of the powers under the Constitution. And that's where he went wrong. That's where he brutalized my nephew and the two Cartwright brothers. And for that, unfortunately, the police force is going to have to pay. Ferguson is whatever charges they come up with, but the monetary claim is going to come out of their budget. Mm. And another reason why I got to get in there real quick, because, you know, their budget's probably getting smaller this year, so ain't going to be no money in there for my client so I can get the money out.
Yes. And, you know, and it's so crazy because I can only imagine as a parent getting that news. And, you know, I got to speak with Ms. Butler last night and, you know, her first reaction is, what did they do? You know, and that's, listen, good parent, you know, how you get here? You know, and you're mad with your child because you're right. How you get here? How you end up here? There's a process in law where if you're innocent or guilty, the process should be the same. Let the law do its job. But if the law enforcers are seeking to be the enforcer of physical harm and judgment, that to me is where we've crossed the line from civil society into a place that is of total disrepair. We cannot be civilized people if these are the institutions and the issues that we face. Mr. Butler, I'm going to, you know, as time is wound up on us, which is surprising as usual, but we will continue this. I hope that you keep us abreast here on the show. And I'm praying for your nephew, Mr. Butler, a young Mr. Butler, and I'm seeing the damage. And in some of the photos that I'm showing, what's maybe hard to identify is that there's a line going across his chest, and that where you can see the bruising. And I'm sure that the days after it got worse. But we have a lot of work to do there. Thank you so much, Craig Butler.
And thank you for giving me the opportunity to explain.
Yeah, no, you're great, man. Listen, we got to do this again. Thanks, buddy. All right.
Take care. Goodbye.
Take care. Bye-bye. All right, you're listening to The Hit Back with Nahasha Black. That was the update there from the attorney of the young men who found themselves a part of a sad story, a part of a sad reality, which I'm sure they did not intend to be a part of. And this is why we have to find a standard. Standards are important because once a standard is set, then you don't find yourselves falling beneath that standard. There should be a standard in policing, a standard in how we interact with each other so that these are seen that happen. Standards are valuable. They create a sort of society or a place or as a person where there is a limit to how far or how low you go. That's what we want. A limit, a lid on the length or the depth at which you go. And our police officers, our Royal Bahamas Defense Force officers, are given the ability to execute persons. They have a license to kill because of the position that they're in. So we are not here to kill them. We're not here to crucify them. We need them. However, as a citizenry, we must also trust them. And that is what is so important. This is a two-way street. You have a gun, I must trust that you're competent. You have the law on your side. It's like being a bad prefect in high school, a bully. That's what you end up calling him, a bully. But we got to go, because on the other side of the show, I have joining me an illustrious woman, first-time guest on the show, and I'm super excited, Madam Joy Jibrilu. What am I doing? I'm messing up the whole name now. So excited to have on the show. I'm messing
on
up.
Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas. For the past 33 years, Great Commission Ministries has been defending the poor and hurting, feeding the hungry, and sheltering the homeless. We invite you to support our Live to Give program and make a difference in these challenging times. Become a donor by giving a one-time annual gift or a monthly donation of $50 or $100. Call Great Commission Ministries at 325-5801 for more details. Or visit our headquarters at 237 Wolf Road. Join Live to Give today. This public service announcement is proudly sponsored by this radio station.
Cancer is smart. It pushes us. We push back, challenging conventional thinking, finding smarter solutions. That's what makes Cancer Treatment Centers of America one of the leaders in precision cancer treatment, using tools like advanced genomic testing and immunotherapy to bring more options to our patients. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. We're not just fighting cancer anymore. We're outsmarting it. Visit Cancer's to learn more.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
And we're back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Joining me now, I'm very excited to have this guest on my show. This is the first time she has graced The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. I know Zhivago has monopolized her for like forever. And so I'm so excited. I used the opportunity. She wished me a happy birthday. So you go in for the kill. You don't even mince words. You say, really? You really wanted to say happy birthday? There's a present that I can borrow from you. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is how you broker a deal and you get someone as large as this wonderful woman that is joining us today. The director of tourism, who I would say is more than just the director of tourism. She is the face of tourism in the Bahamas. I wonder if the minister feels that, if he knows. Mistress Joy Jibrilu, how are you today?
I am wonderful, Nahaja, and thank you for such a warm welcome. And you're absolutely right. That was the sequence of events. Wishing you a happy birthday, and you came right in. And I think that's, there's a message in that. Sometimes we have to seize the opportunities because you don't know what the outcome will be. And it's a pleasure and a privilege to be here with you.
Well, listen, it's a pleasure and the honor is all mine. Thank you so much. And, you know, there is no time like the present, right? There are many opportunities. Perhaps we could have done this, but none other than this moment where I think it is so apropos that I you know, tap into the mind going on, right? And so much trepidation for many when we look at the story of tourism, but yet there is good news. So I want to start there, Mr. Brulu. When we look at the fact that Bahama just brought in 600 people, and that is great news, great news. But we do know that they let go of a few people from the Grand Hyatt. And it made me think maybe there is something there because we know that there's one property, but it's different. Well, it's three properties, but one major conglomerate that runs it. So maybe there is a trend that I'm not seeing. Maybe they that is an indicator of something in terms of how this market is working. SLS, Rosewood, are more high-end hotels. Mm-hmm. And the Grand Hyatt, though expensive for us Bahamians, is considered not as high end, which is surprising. What would that picture painted if we were looking at it the way I'm looking at it? What should it be telling us? That interaction from 100 being let go from Grand Hyatt, but 600 being brought in to between the SLS and Rosewood. What sort of trend is that or indicator?
Yeah. And so you're right. You started off with the good news that 600 people have imagined what that must have been like if you've been without work for a year. And I know many, many, many tourism employees, stakeholders who have not worked for a year. There's still other hotels that are still closed. So just so really happy for them. But yet on the other hand, you are letting some people go. And it's amazing that you keyed in that the high-end properties, they're taking on people, and the other property perhaps is letting go. What is that trend? COVID has been very interesting from a travel and tourism perspective. I know people think that I'm an eternal optimist. They keep saying, what am I seeing that no one else is seeing? And oftentimes we see data and the data is telling, but it would cause you to pause because you are seeing trends. You are seeing the pent-up demand and the desires of people. And one thing we've learned with COVID is that everyone feels it's their right to travel. They miss it. And they're saying, boy, I can't wait to get on a plane. I can't wait to take a journey. I mean, I smiled at you that you've taken a trip to Grand Hyatt. I say to people, in 1 year, the furthest I've gone once was Paradise Island. So I haven't even ventured that far. So I commend you, you know, for taking that step. But the amount of people who do want to travel. But we cannot ignore the fact that it is a lot more difficult to travel. There are impediments to travel during this season, and those impediments are cost-related. And so all the additional costs, not just to travel to the Bahamas, but to travel globally, the requirements for travel health visas, it's becoming global now, a global requirement, even if you have to quarantine in place, it means that there is a certain segment of society who they won't feel it as much as perhaps you and I taking a trip and having to think about it. So even in the Bahamas, throughout the pandemic, without a doubt, it was that niche market, that top end, the high-end brand. Mm-hmm. Interestingly enough, there's a very high-end hotel in New Providence. They recorded their best Christmas ever. Really? Yes, these are the stats that we're seeing. Who would have imagined? Who would have thought? But that's what's happened, because those with the funds, with the capability, they are able, whether privately, on a jet, mm-hmm. on a boat, on a yacht, they can escape, they can get away. They have someone to do the hard work of applying for a health visa. Yeah. And it becomes very easy for them, and they do want to get away. But we know that others have that same desire, that same want. And hopefully, as things improve, we will see people returning to travel.
You know, what is interesting about that, Mrs. Jibrilu, is that my mind then goes to this idea. Okay, and I'm sure you guys have you're working on it, and so that's why I'm not that brilliant. I know you guys are working on this. It is a niche market then. So we've kind of figured out to a certain extent that those who are traveling are those who have more funds, who have it a bit easier to navigate these requirements, right? Hopefully not circumventing requirements. We would hope not, but, you know, the rich tend to get away with a lot more than the poor, but we digress. But that there is that niche. How is tourism and the Ministry of Tourism, have you guys carved out how to attract this niche? And I would think, because we are a high-end destination to a certain extent, more than a family one. But I would think that we're primed to receive more tourists of that ilk.
Without a shadow of a doubt. And I have to say, our protocols are such. There is no... I would love to say there's no circumventing them. People understand them. They respect them. In fact, they have faith in them. A lot of the comments we have is that we took comfort in the fact that we had to do all that we needed for entry into the Bahamas, because it gave us the assurance that it was a safe destination. So for people traveling, none of them have seen it as an impediment or a difficulty compared to other jurisdictions. It took a while. It happened overnight. It's an evolution, and it continues to evolve, but we're getting better and better and better. We started this journey, obviously, back in July of last year. And we can't kid ourselves. We offer a multiplicity of product, of offerings, etc. But by and large, the Bahamas is not an inexpensive destination.
Right.
If you see many of our top hotels, whether it's the Four Seasons Ocean Club, whether even on the Family Islands, the Rosewood, the SLS, let's look at Harbor Island and our Family Islands. Those are the properties that do well. They cater to a special market that can come here, that can, in the time of COVID, social distance. No one bothers them. We have a reputation in the Bahamas that people, you coming in as a guest, no one's that interested. Although I say that there are one or two people, Tyler Perry, someone made that comment to him, and his response was, really? Everywhere I go, people, you know, bother me. There are exceptions, but by and large, we do not disturb. They feel safe. They feel that we offer the product that makes them comfortable, that they can come and literally escape and get away. In fact, over the last few months, if Bahamians had any idea of the types of people who visited our country, we'd actually be astounded, absolutely astounded.
When you look at the numbers that we've had, how would you say that we're trending, Madam Director? How would you say we're trending with tourism? Obviously, it's not great. Obviously, no. I wouldn't even know if we call it good. So are we trending in the right direction, or is it flat at the moment? And what are some of the strategies to perhaps give us a boost in the short to medium term?
Yeah. And I would be absolutely wrong if I said, we're trending really well. Numbers for January were astounding. And astounding, not in a possible way, not in a good way. I mean, I looked at them, and that's when you say, oh, my goodness. But they're good and the bad. So let me talk about the hotels, and I'm going to be really transparent here. Average occupancy for all our hotels for the month of January was approximately 8% across the board. If you could imagine what that must be like for a hotel property.
Wow.
But Nahaja, can I tell you something interesting? And I've listened to you many times. I know you understand economics. I know you understand financing. Mm-hmm. During this time, the average daily rate is 5% higher than it was last year or the year before. So if you could both figure 25% higher, lower occupancy rate, higher average daily rate.
Yes.
In fact, I've got a note. An increase of the average daily rate of $66. But that tells us something in tourism, that those who are prepared to travel are prepared to pay for it.
That's it.
Time. And we, again, you know, we've got to recognize what we have. And no, this isn't the time necessarily to lower your AD rate, but to maximize upon it. So even though your occupancy may not be as high, you're not doing as badly as if you had reduced your average daily rate, thinking that that was what would attract people. Strategies, you asked, what are we using? We talked about niche markets, what we call them, niche and vertical markets. The yachting industry, private aviation, the Bahamas is a prime destination for anybody coming from North America who wants to yacht. And we have seen an incredible upward trend in arrival numbers. Can't get over to Europe where they go traditionally. They can't go further south because they're saying all the different protocols for entry. So if I want to go from Antigua to St. Lucia to the Grenadines, for example, that's so many different entry protocols. They can come to the Bahamas, visit five islands, and it's one entry protocol. So they're finding that this is our yachters, very, very attractive. So there are these competitive edges that we have. We've always had them, but it's maximizing upon them at this time.
No, that was actually very good. And you know, I love the fact that that occupancy rate thing, and that's something I hope people who are doing vacation rentals, my Bahamians are doing vacation rentals. No. Consider that, please. Do not fight on price. Find your competitive niche. And that is one that is very good. I like that. And it makes sense, too. Trust me. I figured that out last weekend before last, but I digress. So what's interesting with that, then, when you talk about the yachting as a niche and other niches, have we been able to look at the return on investment of targeting these particular areas? So have we seen, and perhaps you can give us some numbers if you have them. I know this is not a question I prepared you for, but what are the margins? What sort of increase we've seen in terms of revenue from saying yachting, or how would we get revenue through the yachting protocol? Because of course, now we're going island to island. Some keys, there aren't any customs. There's no, I don't think we, you know, there may be a harbor fee or a port fee, but not many places have that.
Yeah. Well, the great thing about yachting in the Bahamas is there's a main port of entry. You're coming from Florida, you're going to hit Bimini, Cat Key. And so there's certain points that you've got to hit to enter the archipelago. And that's where people tend to go to clear customs, declare that they're here, and whatever fees that need to be. One of the things that we've done during this pandemic, and not, I'm talking we collectively, not necessarily just the Ministry of Tourism, and in this instance, I want to give a shout out to Customs because they've been hard at work during COVID, coming out with their click to clear cruising permit program, which is all digital. And what this is a way to capture revenue, because we know that the amount of revenue that was being wasted from the yachting industry, from this business, I can't put a dollar figure to it. I know that there have been estimates. They're all estimates, but we're talking about considerable amounts and amounts that would make a difference to our treasury. And so to know now that this is now one of the ease of doing business processes that's unfolded, it's all digital. Boaters can now go online, click to clear to come in, pay whatever's due to customs. They can do it digitally rather than trying to find the one man in some key that you talk about that's not manned, etc. ask me this question in 6 months' time when we're able to track where were we in January of 2021 and where are we July 2020 in terms of revenue collection. And I hope it's considerably a considerable difference, but this is something to be honest with you. The Association of Bahamas Marinas have been bemoaning and getting that, saying we're not doing enough to collect the fees that are due to us. And so anything, especially these critical times when we need to find every single way to plug every gap where we're seeing leakages of finances, this is a great way and a great start. So shout out to all our partners. It's been a pleasure to work with them to see these innovative initiatives come on stream.
For my listening audience, if you're just tuning in, the director of tourism, one of the nation's brilliant Bahamians, Madam Joy Jibrilu, joining us on the show today. So then, Madam Jibrilu, when we look at where we are today, right? And I, because there are other properties that I look at, right? Sandals has opened, of course, they lost their owner. I think his name is, what is
the Gordon Butchard.
That's right. That he's recently passed away. Yeah. And almost every Sandals location is open. And I think we have Emerald Bay Exuma that I think that's open as well. Is that open? Am I correct on that or no?
Correct. Although just recently opened in February. Yes. So, yeah.
So they're just recently open, which is great news.
Yeah.
I'm not certain of the occupancy, but my question was going to lead to any particular reasoning given by Sandals why they have not chosen to open up the new Providence location.
It's a good question, and it's an obvious question. We're all asking the why. We're all in my discussions with Adam Stewart, the new chairman, president of the Sandals chain. He was always very actively involved. It's the why. I accepted a few months ago when he talked about the constantly changing entry protocols for the Bahamas and obviously where we were with our journey with COVID. We all agree that we've passed that and our entry protocols, in fact, has become almost the template for the rest of the region. And also our journey and where we are and the fact that we have safely been able to maintain it. So, we still ask the question why. Yeah. We're in constant dialogue, and they're telling us they're opening. We expected end of March, and most recently now I'm seeing first week of May. Yeah. But it is the dialogue. There does not seem to be any particular reason as to why not. But I think with the opening of Exuma, the Sandals in Exuma, Emerald Bay, that bodes very well for us. And interestingly enough, that's been one of their prize properties. And so it is surprising that it took so long to open. So I think it's up to us to demonstrate too with that property. With marketing, the Ministry of Tourism has its role. Sandals obviously is doing a phenomenal job on their own in marketing. And our consistency with our protocols, with us ensuring that our numbers stay where they are, that we don't see any sort of spike, but we're doing the right things. And if we continue to demonstrate that, I can't see this being a conversation we'll be having for much longer.
Yes. And you know what's so fascinating about Sandals and not opening here in New Providence? In Jamaica, just recently, Jamaica's dealing with a big COVID surge, and they had in one day over 700 positive cases. But New Providence isn't open? Family, I don't understand. So, I don't get it. I don't know. I have to find out if tourism did something to Sandals, man. That's what.
And then if you find that out, please whisper to me so we can correct it immediately.
I will. I'm on that.
So, Nahaja, this is personal to me, and I try not to keep it personal, but my son and his wife are employees of Sandals in New York. So yes. You know.
Yeah. You're ready for that to open.
Yeah.
The reality is that there's so many of us affected by these closures. And that it is affecting people's station in life. And so this is such, I know that you guys at tourism are taking all of this very, very serious, not just seriously, but it's weighty when you consider how many people are unemployed and across all spectrum of professionals involved in the hotel and the tourism industry. So I know, of course, that it is a weighty proposition there for you.
And that's why I actually mentioned my own children. And I did it in the context when people say, but you don't understand, you're not feeling it. I'm living it every single day. And yet it's not that it's that I feel it. I know what they're going through up close and personal. And you imagine that magnified across it. I feel it. I feel it keenly. And so whatever is in our power to do, we are doing it. We have worked around the clock tirelessly because that sense of responsibility, that sense of burden, it rests upon you. So many people are depending upon you.
You know, and that's what makes this such an important conversation to have. And I gather a question, you know what, let's take the break right now. Let's take a break. And when we come back, we'll be discussing a bit more with the director of tourism. I'm not going to run out anymore. Madam Joy Jibrilu joining us here on The Hit Back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. We'll be back right after this.
Alternative Dispute Resolution, or ADR, is a method for avoiding formal litigation and court proceedings. Whether through mediation or arbitration, ADR methods are less expensive than court proceedings and don't necessarily require legal counsel. ADR can be an effective and neutral legal alternative for any dispute. Find your happy medium by using ADR today. ADR Bahamas, the legal alternative. Visit ADRBahamas.org for more information.
Or call 394-7800. That's 394-7800.
Feel like a sweet treat? Have a snack pack pudding or gel. A convenient, delicious, ready-to-eat snack for the whole family. Snack Pack is full of great taste and no preservatives. Need a pick-me-up? Treat yourself to a mug of Swiss Miss hot chocolate. Enjoy wonderful chocolate goodness by just adding hot water. Your whole family can enjoy Swiss Miss hot chocolate any time of the day. Distributed by the Del Venus Agency Limited.
Always on the go? Missed the show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
So I was looking for a shipment company who bring in items on time, who don't charge all your pension savings, who got good customer service, and who does deliver. And someone said try Airborne Freight and Cargo Services. So I called the number a man answered. I asked the man if he had the testicular head to make sure my eye for 2 seconds. What did he say?
Ma'am, I'm one of the titular heads, but I can guarantee that your packages will arrive safely and on time.
Long story short, I get my teens and I'm a happy customer. I like Airborne Freight and Cargo Services. It's the smartness for me.
Airborne Freight and Cargo Services. Call them at 377-4050.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you'll also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to a Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
Hey! Got to pay back! Revenge! I'm mad! Got to get back! I need some get back!
Back, you're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black, Director of Tourism, Madam Joy Jibrilu, joining here again. It's a pleasure having you. Madame Jubilu. And I'm telling you, I'm so happy. You know, you made a black girl very happy, right?
That's two of us. And that's what we support each other. And not just for International Women's Day, but we should do that. That should
every
be the
day.
Norm.
Yeah, that should be the norm. Yeah. And I appreciate it so much. And knowing that there are a lot of us who are just doing wonderful things and being able to connect and use each other's gifting to help uplift others is fabulous. And I really do appreciate the time. Okay, so let's talk tourism. There's so much. Okay, so there's a lot that has happened or that has happened in the past year or so. And I wonder, when tourism looks at the entire spectrum, because you guys know exactly what tourism is. Tourism is culture. Tourism is the buildings. Tourism is the people. It is all of these things. And so a part of the tourism model is the straw market, that space. Well, not the model, but the things that make it up, right? This cultural connection. There are a lot of people who, because of COVID, may not have worked in the hotels, but worked in areas of tourism. Mm-hmm. Does tourism count those persons within their scope when we talk about those affected by tourism, by the lack of tourism? Does the Ministry of Tourism count all of these persons who were on Junkanoo Beach as vendors, who were in the straw market, the downtown stores, those who were doing tours, taxi cab drivers? Does the Ministry of Tourism add them in the count of those affected or a part of the tourism model?
Without a shadow of a doubt. And if we look at it at another level, if you look at contribution to GDP from tourism in the Bahamas, mm-hmm. you look at direct contribution, you look at indirect, you look at induced contribution. Mm-hmm. And all of these people, they make up the whole gamut of that contribution to GDP. So we can't count them on one hand and not count them on the other hand. Mm-hmm. And so the totality is has been a consideration of tourism and even the reopening of tourism and looking at when could we reopen, what could we open, having to say, well, at what stage will our vendors come back? Or our hair braiders, you name it, all of that was part. And in fact, it's incumbent upon us, we're the spokespersons for these groups of people. And so, and that's why it is also still painful to know that there are still people who are waiting for the larger tourism product to open up. When you talk about the straw market, when you talk about beach vendors, mm-hmm. and that's the painful aspect of this pandemic.
Mm. Internationally, how has the Bahamas been viewed based on what you've learned during mm-hmm. this pandemic? You mentioned, hey, the protocol's changing sometimes or that it is expensive. But overall, what would you rate before COVID and then after COVID, the viewpoint of tourists visiting? Because and this question will then lead into the next, which is a discussion on the port and the argument by Carnival Cruise Line's senior executive saying that we need more, right? Mm-hmm. So I want to get a sense, what were people saying before COVID and since COVID about the Bahamas visitors?
Yeah, it's with many things, but especially with tourism, it's a mixed, the feedback is mixed. Mm-hmm. Now, overwhelmingly, if you look at our visitor survey surveys, visitor satisfaction surveys, and we are diligent with that. In fact, even through COVID with our visitors, we ensured we got feedback from all our visitors. So we look at that. We look at the responses. We share them with our hotel partners. We share them with our taxi drivers, all the relevant stakeholders, because it's important for people to know what people think about you. Mm-hmm. And so you're going to have, you're going to have to look at Nassau, Grand Bahama, very separately to the family island, to mm-hmm. the family islands. People go to the family islands, their expectations and what they are seeking is completely different. They mm-hmm. want a very laid back, very casual, very interactive experience. They want the locals, you know, they love the fact that they greet them, by name, and that they can walk down a street on a family island. So very, very different. So you're going to see 95% satisfaction. That's the sort of average. As it comes to Nassau, it varies, and it varies, yes, from our cruise visitor to our overnight visitors, mm-hmm. our stopover visitors. And you see numbers ranging from average 87 to 92%, people saying they had the best time. And they do talk about cultural experiences. They don't necessarily just talk about staying in the hotel. They do talk about the taxi driver. And it is incredible the amount of people who make a connection with our taxi, best storytellers. And they stories that the taxi drivers told them on the way from the airport to the hotel, but it gave them a sense of place and a sense of understanding where they are. And so those connections are important. And then we've got that percentage who talk about the state of, I'm talking New Providence, downtown. They talk about their repeat visitors, that there are less things to do. And so we've got to look at it holistically. We take what's good. Yes, it's good to be told that you're doing some things well, but when you're told that you're not, that's definitely something that you need to take on board.
Mm. You know, then it leads to this question of downtown and the port. And I did a segment sometime last week or this. I can't keep up anymore. It's a lot of talking. Where the executive, senior executive from Carnival Cruise Line mentioned that, listen, we need more going on downtown. Regardless of the port, there needs to be more activities, more tours. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, is that something that has been a constant complaint from cruise passengers? And do we have the data to say what they are hoping to experience here? I don't know. I'm sure you probably have been on a cruise, and some of us who've been on cruises know those prices inside the booklet ain't cheap. You know, they've been inflated a bit. And but you do see the options. I'm sure that we have options. Tell me.
Of course we have options, but do we have space for more options? Without a shadow of a doubt. Without a shadow of a doubt. And I always say this, and I'm saying it from my heart because I believe it. I feel that we are so well placed to capitalize on an audience. Let's look at the Port of Nassau. 3.7 million people show up there, desperate for something to do. And contrary to what the cruise lines say, the majority could be 51%. Up to 90% of people come off that cruise vessel. And so either you see them walking to Junction Beach or walking up and down Bay Street. Captive audience. But we have to accept some responsibility. And I say that beginning with me, my family. And I'm saying, well, what could you do to take it
up? Yes.
We're bringing the people here. We're doing everything. We've created the environment that they want to come.
Mm-hmm.
What are you now doing to benefit from it? You can't wait for me to say, this is what you do. I can guide. I can direct. And so until we accept, what is it that we can do? Ministry of Tourism, we work with people. We have people who can, we can tell you about marketing plans. We can give you suggestions of ideas.
Excellent.
And that's part of what we do, but we need Bahamians to come together, whether it's a conglomerate, whether separately. It doesn't have to be anything major. Let's look at that walking tour.
Yes.
What was the cost of start for a walking tour? For the number one TripAdvisor tour, food tour, the walking food tour.
Yes, you know, that's huge.
It's huge. You don't need no transportation. You're going to use other people's restaurants.
Yes.
And I'm going to come to you for first course. I'm going to go walk to make the people walk, but I'm going to create a narrative, tell a activity to help. So, you know, when that statement was made by Carnival Cruise Lines, I have to say I looked within. I looked at myself and I said, is he telling an untruth? Mm-hmm. Is there more that we could do? Yes, there is more. But I want us to do it. I don't want that to be the opening for someone else to say,
exactly.
Well, I'll do it for you. We have to seize that moment and the opportunity.
And I love what you said there. So the Ministry of Tourism then, not just dealing with tourism, but is helping folks to get into the tourism business.
Yeah, well, certainly helping from the perspective.
Of the ideas.
With ideas, you've got an idea. Is this a viable idea? and for persons with ideas too, who need connections to the cruise line. Wow. That's a difficult to navigate.
Yes.
We can facilitate that, and we have done. Oh, we have ensured that they can meet the right people so that they could present their ideas too, but these have to be tangible, real ideas. I mean, have been on a cruise, and if you have done tours that excites the cruise lines, you know you can't come half-stepping to be a professional experience. And so with marketing ideas, not everyone has the tools. How do I market this? And so we help with that. The Tourism Development Corporation, in fact, that's the reason why that was brought into existence, to help with the creation of these ideas. And so I encourage everyone, as I said, a captive audience.
A captive audience, yeah.
You know, the rest of this region would give their left arm and their right eye to have even a million cruise passengers. And in Nassau, we get 5.5 in total in the Bahamas. And we're going to complain. I'm upset. I'm frustrated. But I think the time has come that we've got to look at this seriously. Look at the business opportunities. This is creating that sustainable offering that helps us not just become observers in the tourism industry, participants, fully participating and enjoying the fruits of and the benefit of the collective work of Ministry of Tourism and others.
And I love everything that you said there, because that is one of my, that more Bahamians realize, if that is 3.7 million people, your domestic market, 300,000. Why are we fighting with that when you have 3.7 million? Now, how do you tap in to that excess? And I think the fact that Ministry of Tourism, and forgive me for not knowing, this is where my ignorance shined through there, because mind you, I would have been on the Capitol preaching that has a developmental program that can help those persons interested in getting into it. And I gather, before we end this segment, where you can help folks to know exactly where to go to get that bit of information. But I want to ask something else as well. The domestic tourism side now. Something interesting, one of my friends, and, you know, I'm looking at the Easter break, right? I have to get off of this rock. This Nassau rock is driving me crazy.
Nahaji, you that type of person with that pent-up demand for travel. I have to do it.
I can't do it anymore. And all of this COVID saving, right? Because COVID has helped a lot of people save if you have it, right? And so that's a blessing to be able to say, hey, I've been able to save some dollars because there's nothing to do. But I've heard Bahamians complain about the rigorous demands on the domestic side for travel versus the international, you know, the use of an antigen test. Well, I know for folks to come here, we require them to take a PCR test first and then an antigen test 5 days later. They do not have to vacation in place once they're negative, if I remember correctly. Bahamians are saying, though, I got to get a PCR to go and a PCR to come back. That is costly. Would an antigen test not suffice with domestic travel to help and boost domestic travel?
And if anyone remembers last summer, I mean, the Ministry of Tourism, we were so excited. Mm-hmm. The idea of domestic tourism had really caught on. Yes. I think Bahamians being locked up in their own homes, all of a sudden they appreciated and understood what people travel to the Bahamas for. Mm-hmm. We all miss the beach. We all miss the water. We wanted to get out of New Providence. If you were New Providence based into for Family Island, you just wanted to go somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And so we were so excited. There was this energy and the time was really just ripe to make that a real possibility. And then, of course, we saw our second wave. And we know the evidence suggests the transmission of COVID. They love to say us Nassauvians running from Nassau to the Family Islands, and we took it with us. And so it has to be understood that the Ministry of Tourism has worked hand in hand with the Ministry of Health. In fact, it needs to be stated clearly. We can't go one step forward without ensuring that they are completely satisfied with the protocols that are in place. And through all of this, even as we make the push, the domestic tourism is one way to really kickstart our family island economy. And the Bahamians want to travel, that saved those saved up pennies that they've got, and the understanding and appreciation now of the value of a family island holiday. The biggest concern is the cost if there's another outbreak. Is such that they just can't countenance it. I'd like to say as diplomatically as possible, we understand if you've taken a RT-PCR test, which is the universal requirement for anyone entering the country, the family island, if you've been there for more than 5 days and you've done well, then why not have a rapid antigen test? And so we're doing our own behind the scenes lobbying to see if that could happen, because it would be a great benefit to the economy. But I am guided by the health professionals. They've brought us this far. I see you
so ahead. I'm just thinking, I've got a family of five, and well, the little ones is under 10, though.
No,
well, look at God.
Dispute resolution, or ADR, is a method for avoiding formal litigation and court proceedings. Whether through mediation or arbitration, ADR methods are less expensive than court proceedings and don't necessarily require legal counsel. ADR can be an effective and neutral legal alternative for any dispute. Find your happy medium by using ADR today. ADR Bahamas, the legal alternative. Visit ADRBahamas.org for more information.
Or call 394-7800. That's 394-7800.
Imagine. That's where every advancement begins. With an idea that things can be different. Better. Now. Imagine a world where your entertainment experience was all about you, your style, your show, at your budget. At Rev, that's what we've imagined. To join the conversation and learn more about the future of Rev TV, visit us at rev.bs/imagine.
Like a sweet treat? Have a snack pack, pudding, or gel. A convenient, delicious, ready-to-eat snack for the whole family. Snack Pack is full of great taste and no preservatives. Need a pick-me-up? Treat yourself to a mug of Swiss Miss hot chocolate. Enjoy wonderful chocolate goodness by just adding hot water. Your whole family can enjoy Swiss Miss hot chocolate any time of the day. Distributed by the Delbinus Agency Limited.
Cancer is smart. It pushes us. We push back. Challenging conventional thinking. Finding smarter solutions. That's what makes Cancer Treatment Centers of America one of the leaders in precision cancer treatment, using tools like advanced genomic testing and immunotherapy to bring more options to our patients. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, you're not just fighting cancer anymore, we're outsmarting it. Visit cancercenter.com/outsmart to learn more.
Always on the go? Miss the show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere, on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Nassau, Bahamas. This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Hey! You got to pay back!
And we're back. Joy Jubilu, Director of Tourism, with us as we wrap up. Time flew by.
Yes, I did.
Okay, so we ended on a note of domestic travel, and that is a big deal for many Bahamians who wish to travel more domestically. A lot of family islands we'd wish to go to, and the cost is just, the cost of traveling to the family islands has always been exorbitant. But the Ministry of Tourism has tried its best to try and facilitate this travel through vouchers, through campaigns, you know, make sure you're staying.
Yeah.
Yes. And it was a great incentive. And I think it helped a lot of people. And I believe that when the opportunity was in domestic travel, the challenge is, of course, that, listen, the powers that be need to lighten up a smidgen. Let me take my antigen test, which is $15, and make sure I take it again in 5 days. Yeah. And let's support local our local islands. But I digress. We won't even belabor that. Let me ask you this before we go. At this point now, cruise ships are, you know, has been our biggest business in recent years, more so even than heads and beds, but the cruise ship passengers and visitors. Royal Caribbean has just announced, well, I don't know if it's just, but yesterday I'm reading the announcement, and I think it's a recent announcement, that they're one of their newer ships will be doing a three-island tour, that it'll only be doing Bahamian stops. And I thought that was wonderful news and wondered, when did we know this? Was this something we negotiated? I think it's between their Keys and Bimini and so forth. How did that come about?
So I would like to put something quickly in perspective for you.
Please.
So cruise visitor numbers are the highest. So over 5.5 million cruise visitors versus 1.7 stopover visitors. Mm-hmm. But it's important in expenditure. And contribution to GDP is only 25% of total GDP contribution from tourism. So
they should pay a carbon copy tax. Then we should be taxing them.
Yeah. If you look at then, so 1.7 million contributed 75%. So the value of stopover visitors. And yes, we put a lot of focus and effort into our stopover visitor arrivals, and that's because their contribution is felt
higher.
It's so much higher. But notwithstanding, we know the power of the cruise sector, the straw market, all the taxi drivers, they're feeling it. And so we have a duty. But the Bahamas has so many advantages. When I say we're blessed, you know, I'm thankful for my job to be able to promote you know, when I go to Europe and people are showing some buildings and I get to show the blues and just our water, it just, there are parts of it that are easy. Obviously, there are parts that are more challenging. But our geography, our location, our proximity to Florida, where most cruise ships leave and knowing that they have to leave. So there's always been, first of all, a desire for the Ministry of Tourism to look at what we call home porting, having ships just do a Bahamas itinerary. And then most recently, how do we take advantage in a healthy and safety manner? So there are some announcements that are going to be coming out that are positive, that's been work that's been going on behind the scenes. And so Royal Caribbean kind of jumped the gun, but that's one of many. But through it all, there is that light, and it provides the hope that we need. And Nahaja, I know you've had guests on, you've talked about it. Tourism, is this the model that we need? We can't ignore the fact that it is such a resilient sector, some natural advantages. And so in all our conversations, I think we need to temper it with, it's not, you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. How do you add to the bathwater and make it even better? So I want to add that in, but there's some good announcements coming. I'll hook you up. I'll get you when they're ready, but it's soon coming.
Listen, and all in my head was, I'm hoping she gives me a call. I'm going to have to talk to you after the show to say, make sure I'm on the first numbers. You know, I know Shivago's listening, so I'm just saying.
Well, Shivago speed, he has me on speed dial.
Speed dial, I know. I'm going to catch him the night before. I have a plan. But, you know, and I'm so glad that you said that, because, you know, Dr. Gilbert Morris always says to get rid of tourism would be foolish. It is now tweaking it, finding the angles by which you can, you can maximize it, because it's always growing. Your thought, and we literally have no more than 2 minutes, so I give you 60 seconds on this thought. Vacation rentals in this season, how have they been doing? Have you seen any data?
Yes, we do get data specifically from Airbnb, and I'm thankful to the Ministry of Finance. I want to put it out there so they know I appreciate the partnership, that they share that raw data with us that they get. We saw numbers for Airbnb for January. They were down. So while hotels, we were looking at 7.5% occupancy, Airbnb's rentals were about 10% for January. January is a slow month anyway, but there was a decrease from December. We won't even talk year on year. But potential, again, is huge. This is what people want. They want to be able to go somewhere, have their own place that they could do their own cleaning,
yes,
sanitizing, And we see interest. I want to make the Bahamas is ready. In closing, the Bahamas is ready. The government is ready to receive visitors. But we're dealing with countries that are not ready. No one expected Canada to shut travel to...
All the way down.
Or you to do the same. And so, you know, I think this conversation, that it's just going to be a little... It's going to be different a few months from now. So come July, it'd be interesting to talk again and say, gosh, do you remember where we were in March compared to where we are in July?
Thank you so much. It was just a pleasure to have you on the show. Director of Tourism, Joy Jibrilu, all the way from wherever she is, what looks like the Grand Hyatt, but we digress. Thank you so much for your time.
Such a pleasure, and glad to see you in full form, even though you have a cold.
I know, right? I made it through. Thank you so much.
Take care.
All right. Listen, everyone, have a great day. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black on Guardian 96.9 FM. We will see you tomorrow. God bless. We're out. I can do a feeling.